When we were looking for a boat, we weren't expecting to buy this boat. We had a few things in mind, one of which was definitely not going into debt for it, which meant we had to buy it cash, which also meant being fresh out of college, it needed to be cheap. Never knew what love was until I held you. And our plan from the beginning was to buy a cheap boat that we could slowly build up over time, rather than just dumping a whole bunch of money into it up front.
And we knew we always wanted to renovate whatever boat we would get, but one thing that caught our eye with Uma was her general layout. And so we knew we liked the boat, even if we couldn't afford her at first. So we obviously put her in the back of our minds and just kept coming back and looking at her. And then we noticed that the price kept going down and down and down. And then turns out in the end, we bought her and we were able to afford her cash. And she was $3,000 US cheap.
Yeah.
So,
we didn't really have much to lose.
No, it was an opportunity that we could not pass on. And we did a whole other video about how and why we purchased Uma, so definitely check it out. We'll leave a link to that in the description video.
Uma is a 1972 Pearson 36. So when we bought the boat, pretty much everything inside and out was original. The color, the gel coat, the paint, the layout. Most of the plumbing and electrical was still original, so we knew we had a lot of work to do, but because we didn't have any sailing experience, and I mean zero, this was the first boat that we got on. We spent the first year just sort of working on the structural side of the boat and making sure she could float, making sure the rig was okay. We were lucky enough that she came with pretty good sails, so once we had a good anchor and a prop that could spin, we left the dock. And we spent the first 2 years just sailing around the Caribbean, learning what we needed, what didn't, what worked and what didn't, and sort of upgrading as we went. The more we sailed, the more we learned, and the better informed our decisions could be.
Yeah, because starting cheap meant that we didn't have that much to lose. We didn't feel bad about chopping it up. We basically used our boat as our learning experience.
Exactly. We could rip things out, put them back in. If it worked the first time, great. If it didn't really work the way we were planning on it, we'd just rip it back out again.
Yep, and slowly turned our 50-year-old damaged, beat-up old sailboat into what is now our dream home.
If you haven't already, definitely check out the above deck tour video that we made a little while ago, going over everything we did on the outside of the boat. This video is going to specifically focus on just the general layout and the projects we did on the inside of the boat.
And keep in mind that this tour is not going to be chronologically associated with our projects. We're going to start from the companionway and work our way forward. And we're definitely going to leave all the details to those projects in the description video if you want to know more. But without further ado, let's get started. Well, starting with the companionway, this is basically our front door and the main entrance to inside the cabin. This Lexan hatch came with the boat, but it was very inconvenient because we had to remove the entire thing in order to get out. And if there's a little bit of spare, you have to either have it all in or have it all out. So we decided to cut it in half, which makes it much, much easier to just step out into the cockpit or step in into the cabin without having to remove the entire thing. And it's also much, much easier to store as well. Now we can go inside. So originally there was a step right here in order to come from the companionway down to the cabin, but we never really used it and it was always in the way. When you step in, like, if there's any drip on your feet, it would just scatter all over the counter. It was very inconvenient because it was too narrow to sit on and we always hang out in this area when we're sailing. And behind the step was a useless space to store anything. So we decided to remove it entirely and instead we installed an outdoor carpet so that any bit of sand or dirt that is still on our feet when we step in just gets caught in the carpet and then we can just vacuum it out. And now that we're inside, we're gonna go through a quick overview of the layout and then we'll head into the details.
All right, so one of the first things we noticed when we surveyed this boat was the headroom. This boat has 6'4" headroom, and for a 36-foot boat, that's quite a lot. For me, it's important. I'm 5'10", and I definitely wanted to be able to stand up and not have to duck through any of the boat. For Kika, it's a little bit less important because she's only 5 foot, so she can actually stand on the nook and her head still doesn't hit the ceiling. Not having to duck my head or kind of live sideways is kind of a big deal for us because we live on the boat full time. Our boat is 36 feet long and about 12 feet wide, but that doesn't include the chain locker and the cockpit. So our actual cabin space is only about 23 feet long. And the interior, you know, minus some of this stuff, is only about 8 or 9 feet wide. So it's actually a pretty small space. So we had to use every trick in the book to make this space feel bigger. When we started renovating the boat, we tried to get rid of as many visual barriers as possible. So the table that was in the middle, we got rid of that. We made the aisle way through to the V berth a little bit wider. We pushed everything back, the pilot berths on either side, we pushed those back so we could see the hull. And then creating light space at far ends of the boat and also out to the hull was important to make it feel bigger, so you can see the hull on either side. So long horizontal lines, and then we even illuminated the backsplash there, so it makes it look a lot wider than it actually is because it's only about 10 feet wide. There are also two bulkheads right here in front of the galley and right here in front of the nav desk that we cut back and cut down a little bit, sort of the non-structural parts of those bulkheads, just to eliminate even more of those visual barriers. So overall, the space is as minimal as it can be, as open as it can be, and as multifunctional as it can be, because everything in the boat needs to have multiple purposes, and it's our home, so it still needs to be comfortable. So the very first project that we did on this boat, before we did anything else, was removing the non-working diesel motor underneath this countertop. And we eventually replaced it with an electric motor, but we'll get into all of that in a different video. What it allowed us, though, was to have a huge amount of storage space underneath here, which when it came time to renovate the galley, we took advantage of that and utilized it to its fullest. First drawer up here is going to be all of our utensils, and it goes all the way back to this bulkhead. We don't have much because we don't need much, but that's where all of our utensils go. And then underneath the companionway steps, we installed our refrigerator on sliders so that it can come out, we can open that up, get access to anything that we need, and it stows nicely underneath there as well, tucked in and out of the way. It also allowed us to have a massive sink. If you're ever on a boat, you realize when you're out sailing, pretty much everything ends up in the sink. And this one's about as big as we could possibly fit in here. It's actually a normal residential sink that we rotated sideways because it has this really nice feature in the back, which is sort of a drying rack. And we can wash all of our dishes and stack them in there and not really need to put anything out on a counter, which is really nice, especially when we're sailing. Nothing really slides around. We also built this cutting board on top of it, which slides back and forth and allows us to have a little bit more counter space. It's also a very convenient cutting board that we can flip over if it gets dirty. And it substitutes as a serving platter. So if we've got some cheese and crackers or some hors d'oeuvres, we can use it as a serving platter out in the cockpit. The sink itself is made out of a quartz composite, which is super, super durable. It doesn't weigh a whole lot. It's never gonna rust. It's heat resistant. It's kind of the ideal material to build a sink out of. But one of the problems that we had was because the sink was so long, we couldn't really find a good way to put a normal faucet, a normal galley faucet, anywhere in the countertop space. So what we ended up using was a pot fill, which is normally meant to go over top of your stove. We can just bring it out and use it wherever we need to, including over here if we want to fill something up, if we're running out of countertop space. And that just tucks away nicely in the back. And underneath the sink, on the other half of the motor compartment, we have two more drawers. This is all cups and bowls and wine glasses. And then all our frying pans and pots and everything heavy, we kind of keep down in the lower drawer so it stays nicely tucked away. So this composite sink is under-mounted to our Corian countertop. We decided to go with Corian because it's relatively easy to work with, and eventually we can sort of polish it back and buff out any scratches or chips if we need to. We went with white again to make the space feel bigger and brighter. We'd actually never done any Corian work before, but what could go wrong, right? We also cut in some drainage grooves in the back corner. So if we ever wash more dishes than will fit in the drainage rack on the back, we can put them over here, maybe on a silicone pad, and they all drain back into the sink. We built this little fruit hammock in the back to keep most of our fresh fruits and vegetables. It works okay, but because we have it mounted on 3 points instead of just 2, it doesn't swing while we're sailing. And so sometimes fruit goes for a spill, It was sort of a prototype when we built it, and it works okay, so we haven't really bothered doing anything differently with it yet, but it's definitely something that we're looking to improve. The last thing up here on this countertop is this pizza-shaped cutting board, and underneath it is our pantry. Originally, there was a really large icebox here. In fact, it was so large that Kika could fit inside of it. But because it was sort of the shape of the side of our hall, it was incredibly inconvenient to store anything in there. Whatever you put in just kind of got stacked up on top of each other and you couldn't really get anything back out. It worked great as an icebox. You could put almost 200 pounds of ice in there and it would last for a week. But once we installed our refrigerator, we didn't really need it as an icebox anymore. So we removed that and calculated the best way to get the most amount of storage in there. We sort of had two requirements. One, it had to be easy for Kika's short arms to reach. She can't really reach all the way in the back corner. And two, it had to maximize that storage and have an efficient way of getting access to all of it. So it meant something that wasn't too deep, but also utilized all of the space underneath the countertop efficiently. While I was trying to figure out how to have sliding drawer box milk crate things that could all get stacked in here and sort of Tetris in and out, Kika went, well, what if we just made a big thing that rotates? And I kind of thought circles don't have the same volume as squares, but once you leave the space for all of the cubes to slide, this big giant circle actually has about 20 to 25% more storage volume. So we ended up building a giant Lazy Susan. It's about 3.5 feet in diameter and about 18 inches deep. And we aptly named it Hefty Susan because when this thing's loaded up, probably has 200 or 300 pounds of food in it. And it solved the reachability issue. Because it rotates, each compartment has its own sort of dedicated food category, and you can just spin through and get whatever you need. It's all stored relatively easily. And so far, once we fill this thing up, the food lasts quite a long time. So we haven't actually needed to store food in any other nooks and crannies on our boat, except on our Atlantic crossing. When we first built it, we had a lot of people concerned that it was just gonna be spinning around like a washing machine while we were offshore, but that hasn't really been the case. Once we load it up and everything's sort of balanced, each compartment is full of food, it doesn't really swing around too much. If we're heavy on one tack or the other, sometimes it'll sort of settle, like the heaviest compartment will settle down, obviously, but it just sort of drifts just a little bit while we're sailing, and it's never been an issue to spin it around and get what we need. So we haven't bothered putting any kind of latching mechanism on it yet. If it does become an issue, we can build one, but we just haven't needed to. One of the only downsides with Corian is that because it's a plastic material, it can scratch relatively easily. So one of the ways that we solved this was building these cutting boards on all of the sort of major work surfaces so that we could put all of our pots and pans, do all of our chopping, plates and bowls and everything on these, and then we would avoid scratching the Corian. So our third and final cutting board we have over here is actually the lid to our freezer. We built this ice box a couple of years ago. We had a different sort of Peltier device in there for a while that didn't work out very well. What we have in there now is a normal compressor unit from Dometic, the same company that makes our refrigerator. And the nice part is that either one of these can be either a freezer or a fridge. So if we wanted to have two refrigerators, we could. If one of them failed, we could put all of our food in the other one. Or if we're going on a really long passage, we can convert both of them to a freezer and keep fresh food even longer. This space used to be where the gimbaled oven was mounted in the boat, but in land life, neither of us really used an oven very often. And so it seemed like a huge waste of space for something that we'd only use maybe once a year. So instead we built our freezer here and we built our cooktop back here. So our two burner alcohol stove slides out on this little drawer, and we also gimbaled it, so while we're offshore, our pots actually stay nice and level. This definitely isn't something we installed at the beginning. To start with, we had a little Coleman propane camp stove that we just sort of wedged up on some books while we were offshore. That started to leak, so while we were in Haiti, we installed a much larger four burner propane stove that we got for like 20 bucks, I think. And that lasted us for another couple of years until we made it back to the US and decided to get rid of propane altogether. This stove is actually an alcohol stove. It has little canisters underneath that you fill with alcohol. And so far we absolutely love it. It only uses about 1 liter of fuel a week, which is the same size as about a 1 pound propane tank. And that used to last us about a week as well. and it gets really hot and there's no smell. It does a great job and it's super easy and simple to use. And if we accidentally spill a little bit of alcohol, we can just use it to clean up the stove or clean up the countertop. We had to add a little bit of weight to the bottom of it because the gimbal system that came from the factory was a little bit weird and we didn't really like it. So we built our own gimbal system with some pillow block bearings, and then we just had to add a little bit of extra weight underneath to keep that gimbal system smooth. And what we like about it is when we're done with it, it just rolls away. Above that we have our microwave. We actually use this quite often. The cool part about this microwave is that because it's an inverter microwave, when you change the power settings down, it actually uses less power. A lot of microwaves just take the same amount of power, but they just cycle on and off. But this one actually uses less power. So if we're just defrosting something or heating something up, it hardly uses any. And we're only using it for 2 or 3 minutes at a time. So overall, it's really efficient. And we like having it on board just to like heat up leftovers or heat something up while we're offshore, like a baked potato, or even make popcorn, one of Kika's favorite snacks.
Opposite of our galley is our nav desk. This is where we do most of our computer work, our online work. This is where we do the video editing for our YouTube videos. And this is also where we do a lot of our route planning. We also hang out here when we're not in the cockpit on a long passage. These hands can hold the world, but it'll... Technically, there is a pilot berth that keeps going further, but we haven't really been using that space much. So instead, that's where we keep our extra cockpit cushions and also our grab bag. The original layout had a lot of problems, and we always knew we wanted to change it up, just we didn't know what we needed. So we kept the original table for the past 5 years, and this is actually the last big renovation we did on the interior of the boat. The major thing we wanted to do is open the space up, because originally you had the bulkhead that came down and over, and so it created kind of a visual block. And so we pushed the bulkhead back and made the table bigger so that both Dan and I can work in the same table at the same time. Another thing that we wanted to fix with the initial design was the storage issue. This boat had a huge amount of wasted space when we first got it. The table, in order to access the storage, you had to lift it up, which created all sorts of complications. And underneath the table, there were also a couple drawers, but they were so short and we knew there was a lot of wasted space behind them. So we decided to remove the storage that was underneath the tabletop and make the storage bigger by creating some massive drawers. We made these two drawers to reach all the way to the end of the hall and also curved it to the same shape so that we can use all possible storage space. And here we have our camera equipment. And in the top drawer, we have all the little desk stuff that we use on a daily basis, like our pens and our million amount of hard drives and headphones and all that kind of stuff. This table is actually walnut, and we wanted to match what we already had as cutting board in the galley. And we didn't want to varnish it, so instead we oiled it, because this is basically our work desk. We don't mind having some scratches, and there's gonna be some nicks and bumps along the way. But that's okay, because in a way it gives it character, and if we need to, we can always sit it all back down and re-oil it. I also find really useful to have a chocolater inside as well, because not only it's good to be able to keep an eye on things when we're on a passage, but also at anchor, sometimes we use it for an anchor alarm. And overall, it's just nice to have a screen down below that we can see from anywhere in the cabin, just to have an eye on everything. The cool thing is, behind that charplotter, we have our storage for our laptops, so they can stay nice and organized in there when we don't need them. And behind this rolling door, we have what we call it the unknown. And if you're part of the Umination, then you already know what's into the unknown. Winky face. So we won't get into that, but there is one last secret feature that we haven't told anybody else before. We have a wireless charging pad for our phones.
On the forward side of the nav desk, we actually built a bench. So as Kika said, we could both sit and work at the table at the same time and gaze romantically into each other's eyes. It's also wide enough that if we need to, we can also both sit here if we're both working on the same project on the same screen, or if we're chatting with you guys on camera, we both can sit here and we can still see the rest of the boat. The cushion on this bench is actually one of our cockpit cushions. So we made the bench to be the same size. So while we're not out sailing, we can use that cushion in here on the bench, since usually those two things don't happen at the same time. This bench also slides back and forth. So if we want to sit down here and use it as a work surface, or set our laptops on it if we're watching a movie on the other side, and we can also flip it up out of the way, which turns this whole space into a very large open space. Baby, in my arms, you'll be safe and sound. This space definitely didn't look like this when we got the boat. Our boat originally could sleep 8 people, which is kind of ridiculous since it's just the two of us on board and it still feels kind of small. So where I'm sitting now, what we call the nook, was actually one of the first renovations that we ever did on the boat. It used to be just a settee, and then behind it was a whole nother berth. So we removed that berth, pushed all of this back, turned it into this big flat surface, got rid of the table in between that made going back and forth very, very crowded and small. And now it's just this big giant space that we can do just about whatever we want with. And if we have guests on board, we actually have an air mattress that blows up here, and it's almost the size of a queen size mattress. So 2 people can comfortably sleep here. We can also do yoga here. We can stretch. We can work out if it's raining outside. If we have a bunch of people on board, they can be sitting over here while watching a movie. And while we're in boat renovation mode, this whole flat surface, we put a drop cloth on and it kind of just turns into a workstation. It's really nice to have this big open space where we can lay out all the projects without sort of affecting any of the rest of the parts of the boat. So we can kind of be in boat construction mode and still have a functional, livable boat at the same time. Underneath all of these storage compartments are tools. And when the projects are over, all the tools go away and everything's nice and clean and organized and the boat looks empty again. The first massive renovation project that we had to do was repairing all the internal structure that holds our keel on. It had a lot of damage, which we didn't know about when we bought the boat. And we spent about 3 or 4 months cutting this whole cabin sole out, grinding down the interior of the boat, and then fiberglassing in all new structural supports. The cabin sole in our boat was just the raw gel-coated textured fiberglass from 50 years ago. Someone had put some sort of plywood stuff down over top, which we had to rip out because it was all rotten. And we replaced it with this. This is like a click lock vinyl flooring we got from just a normal home flooring store. As you can see, it's pretty thin and it just sort of clicked all together, and put a little bit of liquid nails to kind of hold it in place. And it's held up really, really well. It's not exactly marine grade, but a lot of things on our boat aren't. We just kind of look at the intended use, look at the material, and then sort of decide if it's gonna hold up to the salty, wet environment. This doesn't have any wood in it, so it's really, really durable. And the best part is, if we put any scratches in it, we can fix it with a Sharpie.
One of my absolute favorite things that we added to this boat is actually this chalkboard. It started off as an idea board where we would just draw sketches and ideas and to-do lists and route planning. It turned out to actually be our guest book. When people come and visit us, inevitably everyone ends up writing on the board or drawing on the board. So by the time that we leave the country, we have a beautiful canvas of memories. So we snap a picture, upload it to the vault, and erase the board so that when we get to the next country, we have space for new memories. So opposite of the nook is our starboard side settee, which is basically the fancy sailing term for a couch. But it's a useful couch because when we're out sailing, this is actually where we sleep when we're off watch. We have a lee cloth that comes up and then it basically becomes like a crib for us to sleep in. Underneath the settee is one of our water tanks, and the other one is underneath the nook. We have a total of 60 gallons, so 30 each, which is, for the two of us, is just enough for 2 weeks comfortably using water. Behind the settee used to be another pallet berth, but because we're not the Brady Bunch, we don't need extra places to sleep. So instead, we have more storage. On one side, we have our bigger camera equipment, like our tripods and our drone, and on the other side, we have some backpacks, our blankets, and our sleeping bags, because we've been sailing in the northern climates for the past year, and the sleeping bags have been really, really helpful keeping us warm and dry.
Another thing that we did to keep us warm in these northern latitudes was install a wood stove on our boat. Now, this part of the boat definitely didn't look like this when we got it. It started out as sort of just a hole that we stored stuff in. We quickly realized it was kind of a useless space, and so we cut it open and used it more as a bookshelf. And then Kika turned it into a botanical garden for a while, where she had a bunch of plants and orchids growing in there. But they weren't going to survive the northern latitudes, and so we chopped all of that out one more time, and last year we installed this wood stove. It's helped out a lot when we're out on anchor, keeping the boat dry and warm on those really cold, rainy, sort of miserable days. Another thing we've done to help keep our boat dry on the inside was insulate the hull. From the waterline up throughout the entire cabin, we added about 3/4 of an inch of EVA foam to the inside of the hull, and that just sort of helped keep the condensation down. We didn't insulate below the waterline or in the bilges because the water still needs a place to condensate, and so it cools down and condensates there and then drains into the bilge where we can pump it out. But between those two things, the inside of our boat doesn't have any kind of mildew issue at all, and it's super dry even up here in the winter. And right behind the wood stove is where we keep all of our offshore wet weather gear. It shares a wall with the wood stove, so when the wood stove's fired up, the back of that wall actually gets pretty warm, and all of in here dries out really, really well. So when we come in here with all of our wet weather gear, we can hang it up in the locker, fire up the wood stove, and it all dries out.
In the beginning, when we were first starting to look into sailboats, we didn't know much about sailing, but there were some key features that we knew we definitely wanted to have, like a private bathroom. So this door is the door to our bathroom or head. It's the only door we have on the boat, and it's the only door we need. Welcome to our master bathroom. As you can tell, it's f-ing tiny. This is a 3 foot by 3 foot space, so just about a square meter. And it took the most designing when it comes to maximizing the space, but it has absolutely everything we need. The original toilet that we had on the boat was installed where I'm sitting now. It was in pretty bad shape and it smelled really bad. So one of the first things we did was removing this whole system and replaced it with a composting toilet, which basically was a free bucket from Home Depot, and we made it work. And it worked okay for the first couple of years being on the boat, but it was very hands-on because we had to literally carry it across the cabin while we're heeled over, while offshore, in order to dump it, which basically was an accident waiting to happen, and we would have a whole boat covered in bad stuff. Another problem we had with our older toilet was that when we had people come over, it was very difficult to explain how to use our composting toilet. So when it was time to renovate this bathroom, we decided to go with a much simpler system. We also decided to rotate the whole toilet from facing sideways to facing forward. And we installed this beauty right here, which is a Dometic electric toilet. And all you have to do is press a giant green button and it flushes. When we were renovating the head, one thing that we kept in mind in order to maximize the space was to create a shower system that happened to have a toilet in it. So our entire design was based on pushing as much storage as we could back and opening to have as much elbow room as we could. And we installed a panel with our shower heads and all our buttons for the hot and cold water switch, and also installed a track all around the head in order to use this entire space as a shower, and we can close it up with the shower curtain. We also installed a foot switch on the floor, which is basically a windless button, so that when we're showering, we can press it with our feet in order to have both of our hands free and also to control the amount of water that we use. Now, because we wanted to open this space as much as possible, we pushed all of our storage back and we created this hidden sink that folds out when we need it. We haven't finished the plumbing system for it yet, but the idea is that while we're out on anchor, we can fold it out, use it, and when we are getting ready to sail, we can fold it back and it's nicely tucked out of the way. And this is our V-berth. This is the most forward section of the boat, right aft of our chain locker, which is all the way in front. And this is basically our master bedroom. We keep all of our clothes on each side and also in those two lockers that I built myself. And underneath the bed is also some more storage. So we have the hot water tank on one side, some tools on the other side, and some extra sails and other stuff underneath the V-berth. This mattress is not the original mattress that came with the boat. The original ones were 50 years old and they were split in the middle, which we found very inconvenient when it comes to sleeping and cuddling because we like to cuddle. So one thing that we did was buying a king size mattress from Amazon and cutting it to the shape of the hull ourselves so that we can comfortably sleep. And this has been a dream, pun intended, when it comes to sleeping. Just like Ben said earlier, on the side of the hull is the same insulation foam that we have on the rest of the boat. And underneath the mattress, we also added a layer of ventilation mesh, which helps keeping everything dry. And down there is also where I store my lira. Underneath our V-berth is where we keep our laundry basket, and above it is where we have our forward hatch. This is our giant skylight. We like to just lay out here at night and watch the stars. And when we're at anchor, we can open it up and it creates a really nice ventilation for when we need to sleep.
Because our boat's only 36 feet long, we don't have a whole lot of storage space. So everything needs to serve at least two different purposes, mm-hmm. or we don't have space to keep it on board. And we like the interior of our boat to look nice and clean and everything put away. It helps relieve our stress and anxiety. And just makes living on board that much more comfortable.
We try to keep a very minimal lifestyle. Of the time that we spent on the boat, 90% is at anchor and yep. inside, and the 10% is out sailing.
Yep. Yeah. And yeah, so because we do live on it, it needs to be comfortable. Mm-hmm. It needs to be functional. The galley, the space, moving around in it needs to feel comfortable for the two of us. It also does need to perform its functions offshore and be relatively safe and comfortable for us to take on long passages.
And the thing about making our boat to be an offshore boat, it also depends on where we're going, right? Because when we knew we were sailing in the Caribbean mm-hmm. and in the Bahamas, our list of the things that we needed for the boat was very, very much lower yeah. than the list that we knew we were going to have to add and upgrade for crossing the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. And it's definitely a different list as well as if we were to cross the Pacific Ocean.
Exactly.
So we weren't trying to get our boat ready for a circumnavigation nonstop as a race around the globe. We were just trying to get to the next horizon.
Exactly.
And getting to the next horizon, we figured out what we needed mm-hmm. to get to the next horizon and then so on and so forth.
A great example yeah. of that would be like a water maker. We still don't have a water maker on board, so we still can't convert seawater into fresh water, but everywhere that we've been sailing, water is either free or incredibly inexpensive, yeah. like 25 cents for one of those 5 gallon big blue jugs. So we've never needed to make our own water because we're always within a week or two mm-hmm. of a port where we can get water for free. So until we go to a place like maybe the South Pacific or the Indian Ocean or something, then maybe we'll consider getting a water maker. But yeah, I mean, we prep our boat for the place that we're sailing and then upgrade to the place we're sailing next. And it's just sort of a constantly evolving platform.
Yep.
And what we've found over the years is that there's plenty of aspects of old boats that work. There's plenty of things, the hull shape, the design, the sail area, a lot of the layout seems to work okay. But there's also a lot in old boats and even new boats that's there just purely because of tradition. Things like all wood interiors, for instance, where it's just kind of the way that boats have always been made. And mm-hmm. so it's just tradition. And to us, those aspects of the boat were the parts we looked to renovate first because it didn't actually provide any safety or any better sail handling. And it was mostly just aesthetics. And so we did all of those first. And then we've slowly been upgrading other aspects, the systems, the more expensive upgrades as we've gone.
Yep, and we're definitely gonna go through our rigging and sails and all the systems that we have on board in a separate video. So definitely stay tuned for that. But again, I know we said it a million times, like in past videos and this video as well. We didn't make any of the changes all at once. So we definitely wanted to learn and figure out what the problems were along the way, and then finding the right solutions or even creating the right solutions for them over time.
I hope you guys enjoyed this interior tour of our boat. And if you liked it, give us a nice big thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't already. Ring the bell if you want to get notified next time we upload a video. And we'll see you guys next time.
Yep. Cheers.
Bye.
And it is a wireless contactless phone charger port. What's the word again? Anything about the... Nah.
Nah.
Which is... Someone... Nah.